Yeah, we are live. You can start. Start. You can start.
Good evening, everyone. With great enthusiasm today, Squad Medicine and Research SMR in association with GAMES, we bring to you a webinar on plagiarism in research, what we need to know. So today, our esteemed speaker is Dr. Durga Prasanna Mishra. He's completed his MBBS from JIPMER. He has done his MD Medicine and DM Clinical Immunology from SGPGIMS Lucknow. He has an MSc degree in Epidemiology from LSHTM. He also holds a specialty certificate in Rheumatology from RCP UK. He has also completed his MRCP from the UK and FRCP from Edinburgh. He's also an associate editor for various journals, few being Rheumatology International, Indian Journal of Rheumatology, and is the Associate Clinical Editor for Journal of the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh. He's also a member of Editorial Board, Clinical Rheumatology, Maintained Journal of Rheumatology, and Archives for Rheumatology. Our speaker also holds a post of Associate Professor of Clinical Immunology and Rheumatology in SCPGIMS, Lucknow. We're very honored to have you here, sir. I'll hand over the mic to sir now. Sir, please. Yes, sir.
Good evening. Thank you for inviting me to speak on plagiarism. This is a topic that is very close to my heart because I always feel that when I was a student, there was very little that was taught to me regarding this. So I always have this intent to teach young people what is important to know about plagiarism, and more importantly, how we can avoid falling prey to the scourge of plagiarism. So this is how I intend to go through. First, I shall give you a brief introduction to what is copyright, followed by plagiarism, types of plagiarism. Plagiarism and similarity, are they the same or are they different? What happens if plagiarism is detected? How to avoid plagiarism? And finally, we shall conclude. I have kept the talk at a very simple level. So any doubts at any stage, you are free to let me know. If there is anything that you require me to explain again, please do let me know. I will do that. So to start with, all of you must have heard about copyright. What is this copyright? Copyright means preservation of intellectual property rights in matters related to authorship. What does this mean? What are intellectual property rights? Let's say that one of my colleagues, say XYZ, he thinks of an idea. He wants to make a machine that can detect COVID infection simply by analyzing the breath of a person. So he plans to make this machine. He does some research as to how he can make this machine, and he is finally ready to make this machine when suddenly another similar machine comes out in the market. It so happens that his friend ABC, whom he had talked to about the machine, stole his idea and marketed it. So since it was the first idea was born in XYZ, the idea intellectual property rights rests with XYZ. So basically, if you have thought of something, if you have written down something, then your intellectual property rights rest with that. So why it is important for prospective authors to understand the principles of copyright preservation? First is to safeguard against inadvertent violations of the same. This has implications with regards to moral, ethical, and legal consequences. And also, since you are going to be an author, you want to preserve intellectual property rights related to your own work. What is important to understand is any published content has a copyright, and this may rest with the authors, particularly when content is published as open access, with journals, or with the publishers. These are three distinct entities. So it is important to understand first where the copyright lies so that we can guard against inadvertent violation of copyright. How do we identify where copyright lies? There is this C sign, C with a round around it. This is called as the copyright sign. If you look at the article, somewhere or the other, you will find this kind of a C sign. For example, in this particular article, you can see that copyright rests with the authors. Whereas in this another article, the copyright rests with the publisher. So by looking at the article and searching for this C sign, you'll be able to find out with whom copyright rests. So reproducing copyrighted material, if it is text, sentences, passages, or paragraphs, it should always be within double quotes. This is very important for scientific writing. For figures and tables, you must always duly attribute the source of the figure or table from where it was originally derived. It is essential that you seek written permission of the copyright holder, even if it's your own article. An example we shall see subsequently. For example, this was an article we had written on non-biologic disease modifying anti-rheumatic drugs. These are certain drugs used in large vessel vasculitis diseases like Takayasu arteritis and giant cell arteritis. So this was a table synthesized by us, an original table, where you can see we have summarized the outcomes studied in Takayasu arteritis using these drugs. Outcomes with respect to clinical, inflammatory markers, angiography, composite outcomes, PET CT, whatever. Now, this article was written in end of 2016. Subsequently, a couple of years later, we wanted to update this information because there were new studies that were coming in. We have published this article ourselves. We wanted to update this information. So we updated this information in another article, including the newer evidence, including this table, which looks quite similar to this, wherein again, you have drug, you have clinical benefit, improvement in ESR, CRP, retardation of angiographic progression, decreased vascular inflammation and PET CT. This is not an identical table, but this is quite similar to the one that we had reproduced. The one that was there published by us alone in our previous article. Still, we have to take the permission of the copyright holder. And because the copyright holder of that particular article, once we have published that article, we had surrendered copyright to the publisher. So we had to seek permission of the publisher to reproduce this table so that nobody can accuse us tomorrow of violating copyright. This is very important to understand. This may sound contradictory, but it is important to understand when you publish your material, the copyright may not rest with you anymore. The copyright might have been transferred to the publisher, in which case you need to get a written permission. And in most instances, like these are all scientific articles, there is no profit to be made by us from writing these articles. So because it was a non-profit venture that we were going through with while writing this article, it did not cost anything for us to get the permission. So most likely, if it's a non-profit venture, you are not going to have any costs associated to reproduce that content. Yet you must seek that permission and have it on record in case somebody asks you tomorrow. So how to seek permission for reproduction? If the content has been published as open access, then you can reproduce it simply with clear attribution to the source. If the authors hold the copyright, then you can write them an email and seek their permission via email. If the journal publisher holds copyright, then you need to seek their permission. I'll just give you an example. This was another article that we had published in a journal called as Rheumatology International. So if we see, the copyright was resting with the journal in this case, with the publisher of the journal, that is Springer. So this was the web page of the article. If you go down, you can see this rights and permissions. If you click this reprints and permissions, then it takes you to this page called as rights link, wherein you could now make a selection. Selection meaning you could say that you want to reproduce part of this article, you want to reproduce this whole article, you want to reproduce some table, you just want to reuse some content. And depending on how much of reuse is there, and what is the purpose. If it is a non-commercial purpose, generally it is not going to cost anything. Through this website, you can seek permission for reproduction of the article. So what are the various violations of copyright with respect to scientific writing that can occur? Now, this is the original manuscript. You can see that this hypothetical manuscript is composed of 7 different objects. What is plagiarism is you reproduce a part of this manuscript. These 3 central objects you are taking and putting it in another manuscript, which has also some other content. Duplicate publication is you take this manuscript exactly as it is and put it in another journal so that there is another publication to your name, but it is actually the same. Redundant publication is you have slightly inflated the data of this manuscript, or you have slightly cut it down, but essentially the information thematically remains the same. Salami slicing is when you are taking these 7 different components and publishing them as 7 different manuscripts, when actually you could easily publish them as a single manuscript. So this is a summary of all the various misconduct that can occur with respect to violation of copyright of a scientific article. You can have plagiarism, you can have duplicate publication, you can have redundant publications, and you can have salami slicing. So there are thematic differences also between copyright and plagiarism. The construct of plagiarism is ethical, whereas copyright infringement is a legal issue. And its interpretation of plagiarism is more abstract, whereas copyright infringement depends on the local law of the country where the copyright is being enforced. Plagiarism is an offense against the author, whereas copyright infringement is an offense against the copyright owner, who may be the author, who may be the publisher, who may be the journal per se. Copying ideas is considered as plagiarism, but copyright infringement for ideas is very difficult unless there is a specific tangible expression, say a sequence of words, images, or written plan evolved from that idea. How to avoid one repetition of others' work is required by giving due credit via a quoting or a citation. Whereas copyright infringement can be avoided by obtaining permission from the copyright holder. This may require financial compensation. Time limits for plagiarism, there is no time limit that exists. Whereas copyright infringement, there are fixed time durations as determined by local law. Say something that is bound by copyright may be having the copyright in vogue for 20 years or so. After that, the copyright ceases and then somebody else can copy that. But there is no such time limit for plagiarism. If something is there in the published literature and you are reproducing it, you must definitely give due credit to the source by putting it within double quotes and putting a citation to it, that is citing the original reference. Posting copyrighted content on social media channels is an increasingly activity that is because researchers are now more and more on social media. Posting copyrighted content on social media is bound by the same rules as for reproducing any other material, and it must be with due attribution to source. Now, let's see what plagiarism is. Plagiarism is an act of misappropriation of others' intellectual property, including but not limited to scholarly texts, research methods, graphics, and ideas. Failure to obtain permission to reproduce previously published material and to acknowledge primary sources are the main components of the misappropriation. So if you want to break down plagiarism into 2 things, it is a failure to obtain permission. You must not reproduce anything without obtaining permission from the source. And you must also acknowledge the primary source. Where it was first published must be acknowledged. If you do these 2 things properly, then you are going to avoid plagiarism. So we had seen this before. And as you can see, if say some portions of the manuscript were reproduced without due attribution to the source and without putting them in double quotes, that you clearly want the world to know that this is not your idea. If you are not telling that, then that is plagiarism. What are the various types of plagiarism that can occur? This was an interesting example, which was published in an article written by a friend of mine. So if the original sentence was the mouse ran up the clock, then what could be acceptable as a reproduction? As mentioned in the popular nursery rhyme, the mouse climbed up the clock. What is direct plagiarism? You simply reproduce this content. Image plagiarism, you are making this image based on this content, but you are not acknowledging anywhere that this is based on this content. Find replace plagiarism. Instead of mouse, you're using mus musculus. And instead of clock, you're using chronometer. So even this sentence is an example of plagiarism. The mus musculus scuttled up the chronometer. Mus musculus essentially means mouse. Scuttled up, ran up the chronometer, the clock. Mosaic plagiarism, when you mix two sources, the mouse ran up the clock while Alice went down the rabbit hole. Again, you cannot hide the fact that you are plagiarizing this particular sentence. Patchwork plagiarism, you are copying a portion of the text and you are adding another portion of original text. The mouse ran up the clock and we watched it go. 404 error plagiarism. 404 error is when you cannot get a web page. A web page that was previously there has disappeared. You may say that, as mentioned in Romeo and Juliet, the mouse ran up the clock. You are actually misquoting. In Romeo and Juliet, there is no such sentence. Or you have not mentioned the source and you're putting just any source as per your figment of your imagination. The mouse ran up the clock. That is not acceptable. That is called as plagiarism. So this was plagiarism of text. There are various types of plagiarism that can occur. We had seen direct verbatim copying. There is also paraphrasearism. That is, you can copy text passages with or without referencing, replacing a few words in between, reshuffling words or sentences so that the software used to detect or help detect plagiarism is confused. Plagiarism of ideas. Somebody may have some idea and somebody else is plagiarizing that idea, not necessarily a text. For example, reviewers of scholarly work, researchers copying unpublished hypotheses, copying published methodologies and ideas, these all come under plagiarism of ideas. These are all technically difficult to detect. Direct verbatim copying of text or even paraphrasing of text is more easy to detect than this. Text recycling, if you have published something before in a few words, you want to use those exact same words when you are publishing another similar article, that is called as text recycling. Again, that is also not acceptable. One must try to change the language, be original in what you are publishing, and if at all it is essential to reproduce that content, you must seek permission. Translational plagiarism. Let's say somebody is published an article in Russian in a journal that operates in Russian. They want to publish the same content in English. So they go ahead and publish the same content in English without ever telling the journal where they're publishing it that it was initially published in Russian. So that is called as translational plagiarism. That is again not acceptable. Plagiarism of graphics. You have a nice schematic diagram and you want to reproduce it. It is not your own diagram. It is there in the published literature. So you simply take that diagram or you simply redraw that diagram and you reproduce it without attributing to the original source. If you remember those two tables that I had shown you, if we had not sought permission from the copyright holder and simply reproduced those tables, then it would have been a plagiarism of graphics or tables. Plagiarism with citation manipulation, that is citing non-existent sources or manipulating citations to conceal substantive plagiarism. For example, in a review article, you're taking some content from a review article. A review article has a long list of references. One of the ways you detect plagiarism is if the same list of references is being reproduced along with slightly altered text. That is also plagiarism. So how do you hide this? You slightly alter the text. You use a separate list of references and you think that nobody is going to detect that. But that also can be detected by a suitably vigilant editor or reviewer. Compound plagiarism, individuals like editing agents embarking on stealing, translating, and editing materials to escape anti-plagiarism software red flags. So we shall see subsequently what are these anti-plagiarism software and what are the various ways that people use to avoid falling foul of these anti-plagiarism softwares and what we should be doing and what we should not be doing. So now coming to the concept of plagiarism and similarity. Similarity is the degree of similarity between a given piece of text and the previously published literature. So how can you detect similarity? Using softwares like Authenticate or Turnitin, these cost money and is generally feasible only if you have an institutional subscription. Or there are also a lot of free sites, but these are essentially less powerful because they have a lesser database to compare against. What is this database used to compare against? I will show you in an illustrative example subsequently. So these are various softwares used to check similarity. Authenticate, Grammarly. Grammarly has certain services that are free. Viper, Turnitin, and various others. Some of them are free, some of them are paid, or some of them have some component of it paid. Let's say the first 1,000 words that you are putting in may be free. After that, you may have to pay to use that software. So what are the differences between plagiarism and similarity? Plagiarism is the duplication of content without appropriate attribution of its source, whereas similarity is the similarity of a manuscript to other published literature, web pages, or gray literature. What is gray literature? Gray literature is literature that cannot be easy to search. For example, conference abstracts. You go to a conference, you present some information. It is not easy to search that because generally conference abstracts are not indexed in bibliographic databases, whereas journals would be, but mostly conference abstracts are not indexed. So they're difficult to search. So they're called as gray literature. Or say conference abstracts that are not published online, that were published only in print versions. They also constitute gray literature. Ease of identification of plagiarism is difficult, whereas similarity is relatively straightforward, because it relies on the output of a similarity checking software. What is the gold standard for plagiarism? Is the source from which the plagiarism has occurred. Whereas for similarity, it varies depending on the breadth of coverage of the similarity checking software. Judgment of plagiarism is always a subjective judgment based on editor and reviewer's assessment of plagiarism, whereas similarity is objective as it is provided by the similarity checking software as a percentage. Threshold of action for plagiarism is based on editorial policies driven by peer reviewers and editors' oversight. Journals may have different thresholds, whereas similarity has arbitrary thresholds based on simple percentages of cutoffs. What are the possible actions possible if plagiarism is detected? If it is judged to be minor, then content might be corrected by authors before publication. The journal might ask you to correct that portion of the text or subject to errata or partial retraction after publication. If it is judged to be significant, the manuscript either gets rejected before publication, or worse, if it gets published, then it might be retracted from the published literature, which is not something that any author wants to have. Nobody wants to have a retraction against their name. The author's host institution might also need to be informed by the journal regarding the plagiarism. So this is another problem where you're working, your employers may investigate you if a journal accuses you of plagiarism. Whereas for similarity, similar text may be flagged up to authors for revision. And if the similarity is very high as per the journal's threshold, different journals have different thresholds. Many journals do not have thresholds. The reason for that, I shall subsequently explain. Then the manuscript may be rejected. So what if plagiarism is detected? One could be asked to rewrite the content. For example, you're writing a thesis. If a significant degree of plagiarism exists, then you may be asked to rewrite it. Your manuscript may be rejected, or certain portions of the text or entire papers may also be retracted. That is, your paper that is published is marked as retracted, and a note is attached to that this was plagiarized from so and so source and hence was not original. This was not detected during the publication process and hence this paper is being retracted. Public shaming of plagiarists, people who plagiarize get a bad name and they may be expelled from their institutions. And with respect to publishing, the journal or the publisher may actually impose a temporary or a permanent ban on you from publishing. You may be forbidden from publishing in the journal, say for a couple of years, 5 years, or maybe lifelong, if depending on the degree of the misconduct that has occurred. In the Indian context, why it is important to understand about plagiarism? This is very important because right from the beginning, right from the time you went to school, all of you have been taught that the more you reproduce verbatim from textbooks, the better marks you get. So it is natural that when some of you will grow up and become scientists, unless you are aware that this is not acceptable in scientific publishing, you might as well go ahead to do that. What is important to understand is that it is not acceptable to reproduce content without quoting the source and without acknowledging the source. And this is not something that is taught to us right from the beginning, unfortunately. That is the reason why you hear so many instances of plagiarism occurring in India. It is not the blame to be attributed to the authors at all times. It is the fact that our society, our culture has not taught us this from the beginning, that we need to attribute the source and clearly mention that we are reproducing from this source before we do so. Because in scientific writing, it is not acceptable to simply verbatim reproduce content. Any verbatim reproduction must be within double quotes and must duly acknowledge the source. We did this analysis way back in 2017 and looked at retractions of papers published from India based on a search on Medline. And we found that of 46 retracted papers, 26 had either duplication of text, figures, or tables without appropriate referencing, or had duplicate publication. So nearly one half of the papers were retracted due to what could be described as plagiarism. This was another analysis that we undertook in October 2019. We looked at retractions in the field of rheumatology. I am a rheumatologist and clinical immunologist, so it was natural that I was looking up the literature in my own field. So as you can see, duplication of text, data, content, plagiarism, and copyright issues accounted for a substantial number of retractions in my specialty. And this holds true for most specialties. So plagiarism is important to understand so that you do not fall foul of it. You can avoid falling foul of plagiarism, and you can avoid getting in trouble with this kind of issues. Further, now the University Grants Commission, which regulates higher education in India, has published this in the Gazette of India in July 2018 regarding what are the consequences for plagiarism. They have used similarity checks and have said that the similarity check will avoid the any quoted work, anything that is in double quotes, all references, bibliography, table of content, preface, and acknowledgments of the thesis are not to be included in this. Generic terms, laws, standard symbols, standard equations, these are not to be included. Then they have put in the acceptable levels of similarity in different core and non-core areas. What they have mentioned as non-core is areas like the methods, wherein there may be some degree of similarity because it is difficult to reproduce methods using original language. However, one must still always make an effort to write it on their own rather than simply reproducing the text. And in core areas, that is the introduction, results, discussion, any degree of plagiarism is given some sort of penalty, depending on how much of percentage of similarity is there. If similarity is up to 10%, then it is considered as minor similarity, no penalty. Similarity is above 10 to 40% is level 1, 40 to 60% is level 2, level 3 is 60%. And each step has been given a more severe punishment so that people are made aware of the fact that they must not commit plagiarism or must not have similarity in the text. Level 0, similarity is up to 10, no penalty. Level 1, student shall be asked to submit a revised script within a stipulated time, not exceeding 6 months. 40 to 60%, the student shall be debarred from submitting a revised script for a period of 1 year. Above 60%, student registration for that program shall be cancelled. And if it is a repeated offense, then the level goes one level up with respect to the penalty. And if the penalty in case where the degree or credit has already been obtained, then the degree may be put in abeyance or may be withdrawn. And similarly, in academic and research publication, if the faculty or the student have similarity of between 10 to 40%, they shall be asked to withdraw the manuscript. 40 to 60%, withdraw the manuscript. You can have some implications on your salary and you may not be allowed to supervise a new student. Above 60%, again, implications on salary and may not be able to supervise a new student for a longer period of time. Repeated offenses, again, are given a higher degree of punishment. So also this document mentions that higher education institutions shall create a mechanism so as to ensure that each of the paper publication, thesis, dissertation by the student, faculty, researcher, or staff is checked for plagiarism at the time of forwarding or submission. And they have recommended the formation of a committee to investigate such offenses that may come to light. So what is the similarity that we have been discussing so much? We see this example of output on Ithenticate. As you might remember, one of the softwares that we had seen was Ithenticate or Turnitin. So this is an actual example of a review article that was written by somebody. This was the title of the review article. Fortunately, it was not published. And this is an example of the Ithenticate output. Here you can see that this is the real text and this is the similarity output. As you can see, wherever text is similar, it is highlighted in color. So for example, this particular passage, most of it is similar, except for these two, three words, which the author has just changed in an attempt to prevent the similarity from coming to light. Similarly, this is another sequence of text of nearly 15 to 20 words, which is reproduced by simply changing one or two words in between. Same with this also. So all of this is plagiarism. Similarly, here also, you can see about 30 words, three or four words in between have been changed, but the rest of it has been reproduced directly from a particular source. And the Ithenticate output or the Turnitin output helps you get to that source and recheck that. Again, with respect to these two passages, you can see that these two together are around 50 words and more than 80% of these 50 words is highlighted in red. It means that there is some text somewhere in the literature published online that is having this exact sequence of words like this with these words in between which are missed. So these have probably been changed by the author in an attempt to avoid being caught and being accused of plagiarism. So why am I showing you all of this? It is because software today is so advanced that it can detect plagiarism of this degree also. Few words, 5 to 10 words, even if similar, and if it is in the same sequence, then also it can be detected by the software. So what is the advantage of this kind of a software? You can detect a lot of similarity, but not all of that similarity may actually be significant. So herein, the University Grants Commission guidelines of simply giving punishment based on similarity is not right, because plagiarism is not similarity, as we had seen. Similarity is similarity of the text. if all this was in double quotes and with due attribution to the source, this would not be plagiarism. However, if it all was in double quotes, then it would make the article very difficult to read. It would make it quite clumsy for the reader. On the other hand, if let's say the similarity is less than 10%, but one paragraph of a 4,000 word article, the paragraph is 300 words, that is 7.5%. This paragraph has been reproduced from elsewhere. So it is less than the threshold of 10%. Still, this is plagiarism. This is not considerable similarity, but in the absence of considerable similarity, this is plagiarism because it is not right to reproduce any content without due attribution to the source. So how can we avoid plagiarism? So software-based detection and the importance of human hardware. The human hardware is very important to avoid plagiarism. So since we have all been taught right from school days to reproduce a lot of text, one may actually reproduce text without intending to plagiarize, without intending to actually reproduce it. Let's say you're reading through 5 articles and writing a review of literature for your thesis. When you're doing your post-graduation, you have to do, all of you have to do thesis. So you're going through 5 or 10 articles and you're writing a review of literature. In your mind, you are very clear that you do not want to plagiarize. However, your mind has trained itself over 15 to 20 years to remember stuff verbatim and reproduce stuff verbatim. So even without intending to, you may simply reproduce certain sections from your memory, and this may be called as plagiarism. So how can you avoid this? Habitually reference everything. Make it a habit from now on to reference everything, not only in manuscripts, but also during presentations, discussions, etc. If you see my slides at the bottom, everywhere I have put references. Why am I putting reference for something that I have published? And this journal is also open access. Because I must make it a habit to reference everything so that I accidentally do not plagiarize something. Use a plagiarism checking software if you have access to it. Learn to use freely available plagiarism checkers. If you are in doubt about a particular segment of the manuscript, you can simply take that portion, type it in Google, and search for duplicate text that might be similar to this. So inadvertently, if you have reproduced something without referencing, you'll be able to identify that. Whenever you are reproducing figures and tables from elsewhere, you must seek permission for reproduction from the copyright holder. And it is best policy not to reproduce figures and tables that have not originally been synthesized by you. Okay, if you want to adopt a figure or a table that you have used in another article, that's fine. You can seek permission and adapt that. But if you have not actually synthesized the figure or the table in the past, it's best not to use that figure or table in your scientific article. It's best to reproduce only your own content or to produce something original in form of a figure or table. Carefully read each line of a manuscript, if necessary, going back to the reference paper to see if any similarities have inadvertently crept in. So like you have read 10 papers and you're writing your review of literature. After you write your review of literature, you're putting in your references. Now go back to each reference at the end of each sentence and see where this thing is there in the referenced paper. And also check at the same time that you have accidentally not copied that content without your knowledge. If you have written a manuscript similar to this before, you must also go back and read the same to inadvertently avoid using identical phrases or sentences from the text. And in case you're using identical phrases or sentences because something that may require a specific set of words for expression, then you definitely need to use double quotes and also reference the source. So how can editors and reviewers detect plagiarism in manuscripts? The similarity checking software is only a starting point. So editors and reviewers should use outputs from similarity checking software as a screening tool. And they also need to use appropriate filters. Let's say the word or the phrase World Health Organization is being used in a paper. There is no other way to write it. You will need to write World Health Organization. So is this plagiarism? The similarity software will flag it as similar. You must have a filter set that unless 8 or 10 words are similar, it is not going to show up on the similarity checking software. Otherwise, inexperienced editors and reviewers can think of plagiarism when actually there is none. So by using these filters, you are allowing the authors a degree of leeway so that certain commonly used terms may be reproduced without being considered to be similar. So you must use these appropriate filters in the software that you are used to check the similarity. Also, you need to beware intermittently changed words to avoid software-based plagiarism detection. You need to review reference lists of notable review articles and the order of such references to detect potential plagiarism of ideas. For example, a review article may have been published and you want to write something that is similar to this. You need to be careful that you are not reproducing the content from that review article in the exact same sequence, because then obviously that could be plagiarism, even if it's not the exact same language. So authors, to avoid such problems, the editors and reviewers may go back to that original review article and look at the list of references, trying to see whether the list of references is exactly the same and in the same order, in which case there could potentially be a plagiarism of ideas, although the text may not be plagiarized. Checking images in articles through Google Images. Editors and reviewers may check images in your article by typing the same text and looking for Google images that might be similar. This helps to identify plagiarism of articles. Comparing tables in review articles to prior published reviews on the topic, if they are quite similar, then this again may be plagiarism. Seek a disclaimer from authors regarding absence of plagiarism. Seek declaration of prior conference presentations to avoid unnecessary flagging by similarity checking software. You may have presented something in a conference as an abstract. Now, when you're finally publishing the paper, the abstract might be quite similar to that conference presentation. That is not plagiarism, but you must inform the journal when you are submitting the article that indeed this was presented in this conference before. Therefore, the editor and the reviewer is aware that this might show up on a similarity check, but this is not plagiarism. Abrupt changes in the tone of manuscripts might also be a red flag, telling the editor or the reviewer that sections were copied from elsewhere. So any manuscript will have a flow to it. If a certain portion of the manuscript suddenly changes flow, then it is quite possible that it might have been copied from somewhere else. So these are points that editors and reviewers use to help detect plagiarism in manuscripts. So to conclude, it is essential to educate younger colleagues about the menace of plagiarism, and also universities and higher education institutes need to establish mechanisms to educate the scientists, the students regarding plagiarism, and also provide students and faculties free access to plagiarism checking software to pre-check their manuscripts and thesis before submission. With this, I would like to conclude, and I hope you'll have quite a few questions. We can discuss all of those. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Riven, can you ask the questions which...
Yes, absolutely. Please go ahead and please ask me the questions that you would like to.
Sir, there's a question. If you're taking a sentence or a line from a research paper and that paper has cited from another paper, so should we cite the first paper or the paper which we have taken from?
That's a very good question. What happens often is reviewer articles would take content from numerous different articles and summarize that content. So ideally, when you are citing a content, you should try to cite the original article rather than the review article. Or if you have taken the content based on the review article, then you can cite both the review article as well as the original article. It's best to cite more rather than cite less, because citing less is where all the problem starts.
Sir, one more question is, as a student, how can we avoid plagiarism for assignments, PowerPoint presentations, and poster making from the student level?
Just make it a habit to habitually reference everything. Let's say you are studying the chapter on neoplasia from Robbins pathology, and you're discussing with your friends. You want to say some points related to that chapter. You should always say that in this chapter of neoplasia from Robbins, this is what has been said. We are not in the habit of saying that. If you make that habit right from the beginning, then when you start writing scientific articles at a later stage, once you go for your post-graduation, after that, if you are interested in writing and research, then that time it will not be a problem. The problem is we are never taught to reference right from the beginning. Whatever we are saying that is taken from a text that is not written by us actually should be referenced. So just try to make it a habit, in which case it is less likely that when it actually comes to referencing the content, when you're writing an article, you are likely to be able to reference that. Similarly, you might remember the example of the review of literature that I had mentioned. You would read 10 papers and write the review of literature. After you have written the review of literature, go back and check each sentence from the original source to ensure that indeed this is not copied inadvertently. You are not intending to copy it, but because your mind has been trained like this right from the beginning, right from the time you went to school, 15, 20 years, you have been trained like this. You might inadvertently, without intending to, you might copy it. To avoid that, go back and check. And indeed, if a portion of the text has been inadvertently copied, then just change that. Change the language so that it is not plagiarism.
Thank you, sir. So one more question is, if my study is a retrograde one and it involves statistics from other papers, should I get permission from the original author or just the author's paper in the citation?
You mean to say a retrospective study, or I didn't understand retrograde meaning?
The person has just put retrograde once. I think we'll take it as a retrospective study, sir.
Okay. Basically, I feel the person wants to ask that if you're reproducing the methods of a study, right?
Yes,
sir. I think that is the intent. If you're reproducing the methods of a study, you give a quotation to the original study. You say that these methods were previously used in this study and we have adapted our methods. Generally, it's not a good idea to reproduce the methods simply like that, because every method has a flaw. However well it might be planned out, there is likely to be some flaw. So you can always improve upon that. But always, if that is the source of your methodology, then you need to reference that and try your best to write it using a different language. However, there may be certain technical areas, let's say sequences for polymerase chain reaction. These may have to be copied verbatim. That's all right, as long as you are quoting it, putting it in double quotes, and giving a reference to the source from where it originated.
Thanks, sir. So, more questions. Is it considered even if the source?
I'm sorry, your voice was broke. Is it considered plagiarism? I could hear.
Yes, sir.
After that, I could not.
Is it considered plagiarism? Sources even the cited, sir.
Even the source is cited, sir.
Okay, if the source is cited, is it considered plagiarism? It is not considered plagiarism if you have clearly mentioned in double quotes the exact verbatim text that you're reproducing and at the same time that you're citing the source. So you have to do two things. If you are reproducing a piece of text, you have to put it in double quotes so that somebody understands that this is not your original text, and at the same time give a reference to it. However, let's say in a manuscript of 3,000 words, if at 10 different places you are having double quotes, phrases, sentences, maybe 100, 200 words within double quotes, then it doesn't look good. It breaks the flow of the manuscript. So that's why it's always a good idea to write it originally, to understand what the other author is telling, to give the reference definitely, but write the content in your own way, using your own expression. That is the best way to avoid plagiarism. But if at all certain few segments or a sentence or two or maybe a phrase or two have to be reproduced and there is no other option, then you use double quotes and cite it at the same time, then it is not considered plagiarism. It's just about being transparent about the source of the material.
Thank you, sir. Sir, one more question is, can the plagiarism checkers on the internet be trusted, sir? Because obviously to check the plagiarism, plagiarism in our content, we upload and check. So what if the websites are, leaking our data and maybe they are collecting? So to what extent can we trust a plagiarism checker with respect to the data security that we are giving them our confidential work, sir, before publishing? So.
That's a good question. Actually, I intended to cover this, but I forgot to. So let me just explain this a little bit. What this similarity checking software is actually doing. The similarity checking software goes through millions and millions of web pages every day. Web pages could include PDFs to articles, could include article in HTML format, could include simply information that is published on the web, any information. And they keep on scanning this information and registering it in the database so that when you put a content to check similarity, they will check it against the database. Sometimes some content may have been published and subsequently that web page may have gone offline. So it is no more available. If somebody has copied that content from that web page, still the plagiarism checking software, the similarity checking software, because it continuously crawls through these pages and has been doing so over years, it will still have that content designated as belonging to that website, even though it is no more available. So this is generally true with respect to published content. If you put your manuscript, say, in a plagiarism checking software, reputed softwares, I do not feel that will be an issue. With respect to free plagiarism checkers, I don't think anybody will be able to suddenly take your idea and copy it unless somebody really intends to do that and is following your IP address or something like that. I would think that such instances are extremely rare. If you are using Google as a plagiarism checker, if you are putting sections of the text that you or a colleague of yours has written in Google search and looking for whether it is similar, then I don't think there is any record or any danger by simply putting 100, 200 words and checking whether it is similar to the content published elsewhere.
Thank you, sir. Sir, one more question is...
let us say, sir, we have paraphrased a text from one article, like one paragraph or some part of a paragraph contains a text which was paraphrased from one article, but we have doesn't mention it in a double quote, but we have cited the reference properly at the end of the paragraph. Like, will it be considered as a plagiarism?
If you have used your own original language and given the citation, then it is not considered plagiarism. However, if there was a particular portion of the text that was reproduced verbatim, and as a rule of thumb, it extends more than 8 or 10 words, then it must be within double quotes. Otherwise, it would be considered as plagiarism.
And the content is same, but we have written in our own way. The content is same, we have written in our
if you have written in your own words and at the same time you're also giving a reference to the content, that's fine. That's not plagiarism.
Sir, and like while collaborating with few people, like we usually guide few students who are new to this thing, but still if you haven't find any plagiarism in the checking software, but later after publication or something, like will it, like suppose in case it will be out, like what is the like situation? Because we have it isn't intentional, but it may turn out into an issue. So
that is exactly the reason why when you're collaborating with juniors or colleagues, you must ensure that they are on the same board, that they're understanding these principles of plagiarism and the need to avoid that. Because let's say you are a group of five students who are writing an article, and four of you have done a really good job and one of you has unfortunately not. Still, if that article is eventually accused to be plagiarized, it is all five of you who will be in trouble. So that's why first is we must collaborate with people whom we can trust, whom we know are on the same level, whom we know that they will not do this kind of a trouble, whom we know that they are aware of these principles. So it's best that, let's say, a junior colleague, maybe you're in final year and a first year fellow comes and you're just teaching him about writing, scientific writing. You need to teach him about plagiarism and how to avoid falling foul of it. So it is that as one lamp lights another, nor grows less, thus nobleness and kindleth nobleness. So you teach your colleagues, they teach their colleagues, that's how people will understand that plagiarism is something that one should not do and it can land us in trouble. And ultimately, you, before you are sending a content for publication, you must be very sure in your mind that there is not plagiarism in that content. You might use free softwares, you might use Google search, you might use different sources. These free softwares may not be very powerful because the database that they access is not as extensive as that available to Authenticator or Turnitin. So you can maybe use four or five different free softwares and a Google search. Generally, if you are not able to find significant degree of similarity with this four or five different softwares and a Google search, it is less likely that there will be significant plagiarism.
Even please ask next two questions.
Sir, one more question is, sir, if I want to take an image from the article published as open access, writing that image in my work will be enough, or getting the author's permission is mandatory via an email?
If it is published as open access, then generally the license states that it can be reproduced while attributing the source. So if you put the source, that should be enough. However, when you're writing a scientific article, let's say you're writing a review article on a topic and you are wanting to reproduce an image that is published in another review article, generally editors and reviewers don't like this. Even though it is not unethical, when you are reproducing this content from an open access journal with due attribution to the source, editors and reviewers still don't like it. They would like you to use your own originality and summarize the information using a figure that you have synthesized yourself. So personally, I would not prefer to reproduce a figure that is already published. I would rather prefer to cite the source and improve upon the figure, or maybe create an entirely new different figure so that my article has its own standing as opposed to what was already published.
Okay, sir. Sir, one more question is, what if we have written a scientific paper, but fortunately, unfortunately, we have forgot to check the plagiarism, and it so happened that the similar content was already published before. So that plagiarism from the author side would be unintentional. So will that be treated as intentional plagiarism, or is a consequence on the lighter side for this one, sir?
The consequences would be exactly the same. If it is detected before publication, then journal would generally reject that and possibly contact your institution also. So even if it's done unintentionally, the consequences can be exactly the same. That's the reason why it's very important to avoid falling foul of plagiarism. It's important to understand what plagiarism is and avoid falling foul of it. And definitely do not forget to check for plagiarism if you are not sure as to the veracity of the origin of the content. If you are sure, let's say you are writing it yourself and you are sure that you have written it in a proper way, still at times you may have unintentionally reproduced some segments. It is again best to run it through a plagiarism checker, go back to the source and check the language to ensure that accidentally also you are not committing this crime of plagiarism, so that somebody can accuse you later on. Because whether you do it intentionally or not, if it is detected before publication, then it is likely that it will not get published. If it is detected after publication, then it is quite likely that it will get retracted. And as I said, these percentages do not really matter. A 5% plagiarized article could be bad enough. A 5% similar article, where the 5% is an absolute reproduction of content from elsewhere, is worse than a 40% similar article that has, say, 2, 3, 4 lines that appear to be similar, mainly in the method section, and overall the content is original. So actually these similarity percentages do not mean much, but the University Grants Commission has put these criteria based on similarity. But it is actually important to analyze the content with respect to its originality rather than the exact similarity percentage, because something which is 40% similar may yet be original, and something which is 5% similar may be plagiarized.
Thank you so much, sir. I think that's all of the questions we have, sir.
Right.
Thank you so much, sir. It has been really a knowledgeable and an informative session, and I think all our research enthusiasts will be very pleased with it, and I'm sure they would obviously get, they'll improve the quality of the work with the knowledge that you have provided us today with, sir.
Thank you. Any questions, you're most welcome to send me on my email. My email is there on the screen. You can very well contact me by email if you have any other further queries also.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation. Like, actually, I have gone through your all papers, especially the Korean journals, which you and your colleagues have published on, mostly related to plagiarism. So that's why I have dropped you your mail, so that we have gotten positive reply from you. So, like, it was really an educative session, because, like, even though I read those papers, but it differs from reading and teaching. So, like, it was a very clear-cut information regarding every aspect of the plagiarism. So again, we would like to thank you very much for your wonderful insights on this topic.
Thank you. And best of luck with your research and
paper. Please stay for 5 minutes, sir.
Yes, absolutely.
So we can have a